Are you coming back, anyway? I hope you all can see me now. Okay, we'll just wait for a minute and then we'll join. I think there is some technical problem and you all are not able to join me on the group because I was waiting over there. But I can see that not a lot of you have answered the or taken the assessment as well. I wonder why. Okay, let's not wait anymore. You're not getting the Facebook group. How is that possible? You just have to find it. It's just go to Facebook and find it. It's there. It's there on the Facebook group. Others could join us. I don't know what's wrong. But not many people could join. Only a couple of people could join. It's okay. Let us carry on with the session. Fine. So let us discuss the question paper. I don't know why many of you haven't responded or given the assessment, but I can see over here that many of you haven't given. So we had around 90 people live, but I got responses by 42 people only who have given the assessment exam. I don't know why others haven't given. So let us see the responses that we have got from you all first, and then we'll go ahead and start today's session. So totally we got 42 responses from everyone, and most of you, so out of 42 people, 21 have got full marks. That's 515. That's great. Congratulations. Four of you have got 4 marks. A lot of people have got 3 marks. That's 9. 9 people have got 3 marks. 6 people have got only 2 marks. And there are 2 people who got 1 mark only. So I really don't know what went wrong, but we'll discuss the question paper now. Right, so a lot of people have joined us from across the globe, from so many cities. These are the city names. That's amazing. So we have people from Mumbai, Delhi, Ahmedabad, Bangalore, Kanpur, Amravati, Chennai, Thane, Mallapuram, Doha, Thabazimbi, Akola, Vijayawada, Barnala, Vadodara, Kottayam, Solapur, Bangalore, Kolhapur, Navsari, Vapi, Chennai, Alapuza, Sawar, Kundla, I don't know where. Then we have from Esfahan, Iran, Latur, Riyadh, and many more. Alright, so let us go ahead and see the first question. According to the reverse concept by myself, we have to invest maximum on the light source. That was the correct answer. I can see that 30 of you have answered it correctly, but 12 of you couldn't answer correctly. Some of them have said invest maximum on the camera. 4 people, in fact, have said invest maximum on the camera. And that is incorrect. We don't need an expensive camera for dental photography and documentation, or even for most of the general photography. Invest minimum on the lens. That is not a great idea, because 7 people have answered invest minimum on the lens. You have to invest a good amount on the lens, because photography depends upon your lens quite a bit. 30 people have answered invest maximum on the light source. That's perfect. And some people have said invest maximum on image stabilization. 1 person has said, but that's obviously the wrong answer. In dental photography, it is best to keep, 7 person said keep the camera on manual mode and the lens on autofocusing. That's the incorrect answer. The camera on automatic mode, 2 people said, but the lens on manual focusing, that is also the wrong answer. And most of you, that's 33 people, said the camera on manual mode, that's correct, and the lens also on manual focusing, that's perfect. Our preferred settings for dental photography would be high ISO and small F number. Two people said the wrong answer. One person has said high ISO, high F number. That is definitely the wrong answer. Four people said low ISO and slow shutter speed. That is also a wrong answer. But the perfect answer would be low ISO and high F number. And 35 of you out of 42 have given the right answer. That is really good. I'm very happy. The magnification ratio to be set on macro lens for full arch occlusal means maxillary full arch or mandibular full arch images when a crop sensor DSLR is used. Here a lot of people have got confused. Four of you have said 1:2. 1:2 would be on a full frame, not on a crop sensor DSLR. Some people have said 1:1.5. That's a major chunk. I don't know why most of you, 12 of you have said 1:1.5. It is a full arch occlusal image. It cannot come at 1:1.5. It will come at 1:3 only. Some people have said 1:15. One person has said. In 1:15, you get full face. Most of you have said 1:3. That's 25. But the number is unimpressive, actually. Out of 42, only 25 people could answer this correctly. That's a little disappointing. So what I'm going to do is, I'm just going to brush up with you what are the magnification ratios. Okay, so there's one thing called as the rule of five, which I'll teach you when I go live on Dental Photography School Facebook group, because I don't want to put it on the page. But you have to keep in mind that whenever you record a bigger area like the face, the magnification ratio is 1:15. All right. Whenever you record around full arch area, the magnification ratio is 1:3. And whenever you record close up for anterior aesthetics, the magnification ratio is 1:1.5. This is all you need to remember. In fact, just remember intraorally, we just use two magnification ratios. 1:1.5 for quadrants, and for full arch it's 1:3. That'll be very easy for you all to remember. Just write it down somewhere. For full arch kind of an area, it's 1:3, and for a quadrant means a less number of teeth, it's 1:1.5. all right, and for full face it's 1:15. And I'm talking about a crop sensor DSLR, because most of us are using a crop sensor DSLR for documentation. Hopefully that should clarify this question. And I'm a little upset about most of you answering this wrong, but still more than 50% of you have answered it correctly, so not as disappointing. And the last question was, ideal flash unit to document anterior aesthetic cases for publications would be. Most of you have written a very good answer. In fact, only three people got it wrong. Three people said ring flash, which is incorrect. The ideal one would be a twin flash, definitely. And 92% of you have said it correct. So I'm really, really glad that most of you could answer all the questions pretty well. So thank you so much for the assessment. The assessment was a reflection of if I could do justice to teaching you nicely. And most of you have actually lived up to that. I think I should emphasize more or teach more on magnification ratios, which I will. I'll try to be better in teaching magnification ratios. Maybe I've not taught it well. That is why most of you got it correct. Most of you got it wrong. I'm sorry. And now coming back to the question. And my question was this. You all told me what camera to use and what lens to use. Can you tell me if I should use a full frame DSLR for demonstration right now? If I should use 1855 lens? And if I should use this 100mm macro lens, or if I should use this camera, that is a crop sensor DSLR. Okay, so that was my question, and I'm putting the conditions for you once again. These were my conditions. Please tell me what I should use, given that it has to be easy for me to give a demonstration on. It should be less prone to mistakes. It should be easy to focus, and it should be sharp images. I'm waiting for your answers, and please answer me now. You have to select what I should use for documentation. Let's see what you suggest me. I want a good suggestion from all of you all. And my basic requirement is, I want to give you a demonstration. and I don't want to make a fool out of myself. That means I want something that is less prone to mistakes. It should be easy to focus and it should give me sharp images. So what will be the system? Means what camera and what lens do I use to make minimum mistakes so that I don't make a fool out of myself on a Facebook Live? Anyone? Hi, Muhammad Alshiri. And give me a reason why. Tell me why you are suggesting that. Okay, most of you are saying crop sensor 100mm twin flash. Okay, I'm not going to use a twin flash. I'm not going to use any flash. I'm not going to use any flash because I'm going to be teaching or covering general photography. I repeat, I'm going to be covering demonstration on general photography. I'm not going to be using flash. So tell me, what do you want me to use? We are going to take a picture of this mug. We are going to take a picture of this mug, but in ambient lighting or available lighting. So tell me, what should I use? Should I use a full frame camera? Should I use a crop sensor camera? Should I use 1855 lens or 100mm lens? Please tell me the combination and why. Okay. This is a very interesting question, and okay, why I'm asking you this is because everything that I do on Facebook Live is because of a reason. It is preconceived. It is a visualization of what I'm going to be doing, and I want you all to be in my place and decide what we want to use. So my basic concern is, I want to teach you metering today. I want to teach you general photography today. I'm not going to be touching the flash, but I want to use something that's easy for myself so I don't make a fool out of myself in front of you on Facebook Live. So just consider yourself in my place and suggest what I should use. Please. Anyone? Still waiting. I'm not really happy with the answers. Let me keep it like this. No, it's not possible to rotate it. Okay. Okay. I think only one or two people have answered it correctly. Arvind Menon, I think, is the only person who answered it correctly. I'm not really happy with others' answers. I'm happy with Arvind Menon's answer. Arvind Menon, can you explain why you are suggesting what you are suggesting? That will be the key. Can you answer me? Why you are suggesting what you are suggesting, Arvind? No, you should select only one lens, Kathy. Okay, MJ Vaidya is saying no flash photography, so no macro lens as 1855mm lens considering the space. General photography, full frame. I could not make it, I did not understand that very well, MJ Vaidya. But this is a very good question, very important question, and it's going to help you understand a lot of things. That is why I'm emphasizing on this. You all need to understand why I'm going to be selecting a particular equipment. So I'm not really happy with the answers. MJ Vaidya is saying for macro lens, general photography, you will have to go 5 meters away from the subject. Okay. Arvind Menon is saying it's a very common lens used and lightweight camera with minimal investment. No. I have all the equipment. I mean, I'm just saying that I have the equipment, you have to select for me. So, expense is not the thing. Kathy is saying, both the lens. My basic question is, tell me, what do I use? Should I use 700D, which is a crop sensor camera, 1855 lens, 100mm lens, or full frame camera? What do you suggest? What do you want me to use? Okay, so let me be as explicit as I can. I'm telling you to select an equipment with for me, says that when I give you all a demonstration of general photography, in the sense I'm going to be showing you general photography means photography without flash. I don't want to make any mistakes because I don't want to make a fool of myself because I am on Facebook Live. So please suggest me a good camera. What will you suggest? My basic concern is I should not be able to make a fool. I should not be making a fool out of myself. Okay, so I think we've waited enough. And I think I'm going to give out the answers. I'm not really happy with any answer. It's not convincing enough. Anybody would want to take the last chance to answer me the right thing? Aishwarya is saying crop sensor camera, as it is light and weight, easy to carry, 1855 zoom lens, wide focal length. So what? Shashank Kaushik is saying crop sensor camera with EFS lens. Why? Give me a why. Alright, so let me start off answering what I have asked. Most of you suggested something, but I think maybe it's in your mind, but you're not able to answer what I'm looking for. Maybe you are right, but I'm not able to understand what's there in your mind. So let me try and explain it to you all. So what do I have with me? I have a crop sensor DSLR. That's a Canon 700D. I have a full frame DSLR. That is Canon 6D. I have a 100mm macro lens. And I have an 1855 lens. So I have very basic equipments with me, but I wanted you all to select for me. Okay, so how would I make a selection? It would be like this. The first thing that I'm going to ask myself is, am I going to be using flash? So I had already answered that I'm not going to be using flash. Am I right? That means I'm going to show you stuff in whatever light that is available, means ambient lighting, which is very, very low light. Okay, so this, although you can see me clearly, amount of light present in my room is very less. That means if the light is very less, it's going to be difficult for me to do photography already. That means this is a difficult situation for me to teach you photography because the light is less. Okay, now what I'm going to think about is, do you remember the four conditions that I had spoken about? In that, I had specified that it should be easy and I should not be getting any blurring. In the sense, blurring should not happen. That means I should have a quite deeper depth of field. If I have a deeper depth of field, that means it's going to be helpful for me to focus better. And that was also one of the conditions, that I should be able to focus easily. So the first thing that I'm going to be deciding is not the camera. I'm going to be deciding the lens. All right. So this is how we go about understanding what I'm going to be using. So the first thing that I'm going to be deciding is what lens I should use. So you have two lenses in front of you. One is 1855, one is 100mm. You have to understand which one will be easy for me to focus with. Okay, so let us compare these two lenses and let us compare which one will be easy to focus. Okay, So first things first, let us discuss about the depth of field. Any lens which is going to give me a shallow depth of field is going to be difficult for me to focus with. Do you accept that? Because the lens is going to struggle a lot to understand what is sharp. So out of these two lenses that are in front of you, 100 mm is the lens that is going to be the most difficult lens to focus with, because the focal length is on the higher side. And like we already discussed, if the focal length is high, the depth of field is shallow. Do you remember that slide? Or do you want me to show it to you again? Let me show it to you again. Yeah, that's the slide that I'm talking about. If you remember this slide, I had spent 5 minutes on this slide trying to explain this slide. Let us look at this slide again. There are three things that control our depth of field. Number one, that is the F number. If you work at less F number, the depth of field will be shallow. You can see the red band is small. That means the depth of field is shallow. If you work at a higher F number, like the guy in the yellow t-shirt, the depth of field is deep. Okay, so that was the first technique. When it comes to F number, both the lens are almost same. In this lens, I can go down as low as 3.5, and in this lens, I can go as low as 2.8. And the maximum F number that you can go with 1855 lens, that is this lens, is F22. And with this lens, you can go as high as F32. That is okay. That means this lens is capable of giving me a large amount of flexibility when it comes to F number. So both the lenses are perfect with that. Both the lenses are almost equal. So not a big deal. Okay. When it comes to F number, it is a win-win in case of both the lenses. Now let us go ahead and see the next situation. All right. If I come very close to the subject, my depth of field becomes shallow. And if I'm far from the subject, my depth of field becomes deep. Okay. So when you compare these two lenses, this is a macro lens and this is a non-macro lens. So which lens is going to allow you to come closer? I think this lens is going to allow you to come closer, because the minimum focusing distance of this 100 mm macro lens is pretty low, in the sense it's going to allow you to come very close to the subject. And what happens if you go close to the subject? It's right here. If you go very close to the subject, your depth of field becomes very shallow. That means your DOF is going to be shallow. All right. And now the last criteria, that's the focal length. If your focal length is small, the depth of field is deep. You remember that? So this red guy over here, the guy in the red t-shirt over here, say he is working at a focal length of 18 millimeters, so he is going to get a deeper depth of field. That means a big area of sharpness. The guy in the yellow t-shirt is going to be getting a shallow area of sharpness because he's working at, say, 400 mm or something like that. So what I'm basically trying to say is, out of these two lenses, 100 mm is going to be a very difficult lens to use because the focal length is on the higher side. If the focal length is on the higher side, the depth of field is going to be shallow. And the moment depth of field is going to be shallow, it's going to start struggling with its focusing. Alright, so for general photography, in these kind of conditions, when it's a little dark, you can say that 100 mm will be a slightly difficult lens to use as compared to an 1855 lens, that is this lens. Although I'm going to be using this lens for demonstration purposes, I'm not going to choose 55 as my focal length. I'll be choosing 18 as my focal length, because at 18 millimeters, I'm going to get a very deep depth of field, in the sense everything will be sharp. So my lens or the camera will have to struggle minimum when it comes to focusing. So when it comes to ease of use, 1855 lens kept at 18 mm is a much more easier lens to focus as compared to a 100mm lens like this one, okay? Because this one is going to give you a shallow depth of field. Also, you can go quite close to the subject with this lens, so you are going to suffer with the depth of field even more. But with an 1855 lens, you are going to get deeper depth of field. That means your focusing is going to be much more easier because the depth of field is going to be quiet, deep. Okay, so I have decided my lens. I'm going to be going ahead with an 1855 lens, and for general photography, I mean, and I'm not going to be using this 100mm lens because it's going to be difficult for me to focus using this lens, and there is a higher chance that I might make a fool out of myself in public if I try to focus using this lens because the depth of field is very shallow. So this is done. I'm not going to be using a 100mm lens. So I have decided upon my lens, that's 1855 lens, and even in 1855 lens, I'm going to be using this lens at 18mm so that I get a very deeper depth of field. So the lens is sorted. Now you have to decide what camera. Now the answer is very simple. Okay, this is a crop sensor DSLR and this is a full frame DSLR. This is an EFS mount, this is an EF mount. Okay, so can you tell me what lens I should, 1855, I'll use it with which camera? EFS camera or EF camera? Who's going to answer this? Should I use full frame, that is 6D, that is an EF camera? Or should I use a crop sensor DSLR, that is an EFS camera? Anybody? Perfect. EFS, Masa, perfect. Aishwarya, perfect. Nikita, perfect. EFS, you all are right now. So I hope you understood. First of all, I cannot use a full frame when I'm using my 1855 lens because my 1855 lens is an EFS lens. It is not going to be usable on my full frame. If I use it, I'm going to get vignetting. So the correct answer was go ahead and use a crop sensor DSLR, that is EFS DSLR, with an 1855 lens. That is the perfect answer. And the reason for that is I'm going to be using this system, that means crop sensor DSLR and 1855 lens at 18mm, because my focusing is going to be very easy. That is all. And this is how you go about visualizing things. You put yourself in that situation and then you try to answer which lens is going to be easy. 1855 is going to be easy or 100mm. So answer is 1855. 1855 kept at 18, but 1855 cannot be used in full frame. So the only camera that you can use when you are using 1855 is a crop sensor DSLR. That is the kind of answer that I was expecting. Most of you gave a correct answer, but maybe you could not put it in words why you suggested that equipment. But I'm pretty happy with all the people who said crop sensor DSLR with an 1855 lens. So that's how we are going to be working today. And now we start off with our main subject, that is metering, right? So let's go ahead and do our session today on metering. What do we understand by metering? What is metering? Let's go ahead and understand that. Metering is like the camera is telling us if our image is going to be good or bad before we take the image itself. Alright? What do you mean by that is this. I'll just show it to you. Just hold on for a second. So over here, this is your light meter, and that is something that we never discussed so far. But it is high time that we discuss it right now. Alright, so this metering is there on all DSLRs of the world. In dental photography and documentation, we bypass the metering because we don't like to meter when we are doing flash photography. At least for me, I don't like to use metering when I'm using flash. That is why I use my camera on manual mode and flash also on manual. So I control my flash power and I don't allow my camera to control my flash power. Okay. So let's go back and try and understand what is metering. And this is there in each and every camera of the world. Hi, Kingshuk Chatterjee. I'm so glad to see you. Dr. Kingshuk Chatterjee is a very well-known dermatologist in Calcutta. Pleasure to have your company. So metering is something like this, and we have bypassed it so far. But this is what metering means. Okay. Now look at what metering does. Let me give you a rough understanding of what metering actually means. Metering is a meter that tells me if my image is going to be underexposed, correctly exposed, or overexposed. Okay, so metering is something that tells me before I take an image if my image is going to be dark, well exposed, or overexposed. Okay, how to use metering? That is the question that you would be wondering, or you want to ask me. Metering is done when you do a half release of your shutter release button. So if you palpate your shutter release button, it gives you a slight resistance at a particular time. So when you press it, it gives you a slight resistance at a particular time, and that resistance is your half release. So the shutter release button has two functions. One is a half release and one is a full release. When you do a half release, the camera is going to go ahead and meter for you. Okay, and when you do a full release, the camera is going to make an image for you. That is all you need to understand at this point of time. Okay, so when I do a half release, my lens is going to point at my subject and is going to meter how much light is falling on my subject, and is that image going to be dark, bright, or well exposed. Before I take an image itself, it's going to tell me, depending upon the settings that I have kept. So just consider that arbitrary settings. Just consider that these are the settings on my camera that are there on your screen. So what does metering tell me? Now it'll be very clear for you. Please be with me. This is a slightly dry subject. But once you understand, it's going to be very easy for all of you all. So what is metering? My camera is on manual mode over here. If I keep just a hypothetical situation, if I keep a shutter speed of 1 by 200, f25, ISO 100, metering is telling me my cursor, you can see. So this is minus 3, minus 2, minus 1, 0, plus 1, plus 2, plus 3. When I do metering, in the sense, when I do a half release of this button, that's the shutter release button, my cursor has gone on the minus 3. When the cursor goes on minus 3, it means the camera is telling me I'm going to get a very dark image. This is what metering means. So let us see different situation and try and understand what metering means. So you can see over here that when I do a half release, my cursor has gone to minus 3. That means it's going to be an underexposure. With what settings? With these settings. Okay. But if I change my settings, what settings? If I play with these three settings, means if I play with shutter, aperture, or ISO, I can move my cursor and try to get it in the center. Somehow, if I play with my three settings and if I get my cursor in the middle, if it comes in the middle, it's like a weighing scale, means a perfect balance. The camera is now metering and telling me that my image is going to be well exposed. However, if my settings are such that, settings means what? If my settings of shutter, F number, and ISO are such that my meter has gone on plus 3 side, my camera is telling me before I take the image itself that my image is going to be overexposed. Alright, so now let us go ahead and see, does that really happen? Alright, so I'm taking my camera with me right now, and you all are with me, so let us start doing metering. Okay, so you can see right now, my shutter speed is 1 by 80, f2.8, ISO 100. So f2.8 is the minimum f number that I can go. No, sorry, 1.8 is the minimum f number that I can go ahead with. But you can see that my cursor is beyond minus 3. That means if I take an image right now, my image is going to be really dark. So let me go ahead and take that image. Let me just put the lens on autofocusing and take an image for all of you all. So you can see my metering is beyond minus 3. And if I take an image, it's going to be really dark. And you can see when I'm moving my lens, the cursor is also moving. Means what it's seeing in front is metering over there. So let us select an easier subject. So now it's on minus 3. My lens is trying to focus. But if I take an image, it's going to be really dark. So you can see that is my image. At 1/80, f1.8, ISO 100, my meter is beyond minus 3. That means my camera is telling me that my image is going to be really very dark. So what do I do to get the cursor in the center? I can play with these top three settings. What I can do is I can reduce my shutter speed, in the sense, let me try and get the shutter speed slower. So say 1/10. So even now it is on the minus side. But now you can see that it's coming in the center if I'm making my shutter speed slower. And now it is perfectly exposed. Now it is in the center. So now what is going to happen is, if I take an image, it's going to be well exposed. But the shutter speed is close to 2 seconds. Okay. So that's the image that I got. It is a well exposed image. It is a picture of reflection, but it is going to be a good exposure. But what is going to happen is, I'm going to be suffering from a lot of blurring because the shutter speed was 2 seconds. I cannot obviously keep stable with my hands if my shutter speed is slow. But I'm just showing you that we can play with the cursor depending upon these three values. Okay, so what I can do now is, I can also do one more thing. So I'll keep a shutter speed, say 1/60 arbitrarily. But in this setting, you can see that my cursor has gone beyond minus 3. That means it is going to be really dark. So I'm just putting some more light so that it's easy for my camera a bit. Okay, but even in this setting, you can see that, okay, now it has come in the center because I added more light. And if I take an image, it's going to be a little underexposed. So it's not almost in the center. It's not almost in the center. It's around this. So it's going to be visible, but it's going to be dark. See that? That is what the image is. It's slightly darker. I'm going to be changing my white balance to something else because it's looking very bluish. So you can see that the cursor is playing in the negative region. So what I'm going to do is, I'm going to increase my ISO to say 400 and see where my cursor is going. So now my cursor has come on the plus side. Can you see? And I got a beep. That means I'm in focus. And if I take an image, it's going to be well exposed. Alright, so I knew it is going to be well exposed. So my cursor was around this area. See, it's close to the center. That means it's going to be almost like a good image. See, it is almost a good image. It's almost a perfect image. Okay, so where metering is going to be taking place is depending upon where my lens is pointing at. This also depends upon the color of your subject. Suppose if there are two things, if there are two mayurs in front of you, one is wearing a white t-shirt and one is wearing a black t-shirt, at a setting of 1/60, that is like this, at a setting of 1/60, f1.8, ISO 400, if the lens is pointing on the white t-shirt and you get the cursor in the center, that means these settings are perfect for the guy in the white t-shirt. But if you keep those same settings and point it on the black t-shirt guy, is going to give you an underexposure because he's wearing a black t-shirt. So for taking a well-exposed picture of that guy's t-shirt, you will have to play again with your settings. So a lot depends upon how much light is there in the situation and what are the colors present. Colors in the sense, what is the value? More than colors is the value, how bright it is. So white is having a higher value and black is having a lower value. So the settings are different for both of these situations. Alright, so let us try and focus at different objects that are there in my room. Let us consider this bottle. This is a white color bottle and I'm going to be keeping a black color lens. It's going to be different exposure. In fact, my metering is going to be different for both of these subjects. Let me take my camera, and what I'm going to do now is I'm going to point at the white color bottle. Okay, it's probably trying to focus on the white color bottle. So just for the ease sake, I'm keeping my autofocus point in the center. I'm going to be using autofocusing right now. Yeah, and I've got a good focus, but you can see that it's showing an overexposure. It's on the plus two side. So if I take an image, it'll be really bright. This is what metering means. Okay, you can see that it's a pretty bright picture. So maybe my camera was trying to focus over here, meter over here in this part. So that part has become bright. But if I keep the same settings and I try to focus on my lens, which is a black subject, see, it's showing an underexposure, that is on the minus side. I've not changed the settings, but it is telling me that my subject will be underexposed. My subject is underexposed. I'm not talking about the background. I'm talking about my subject over here. Okay. So it's going to tell me that my subject is underexposed. Over here, what is happening is I expose for the lens. My lens was underexposed at these settings, but just behind the lens we have a very bright background. So what has happened is the camera was telling me that my subject is going to be dark, but my background is going to be bright because there is such a big contrast between the two. This is called as dynamic range. So this is where things start getting a little tricky. But the basic thing that you need to understand is metering. If you try to get the cursor in the center, you'll have a good exposure. If you get the cursor on the left hand side, it'll be underexposure. If you get your cursor on the right hand side, it is going to be overexposed. How to keep on moving this cursor is through these three settings: 1/60, f number, and ISO. If I play with these three, the cursor keeps on playing in between these points or in between these values. All right. That's about metering. Metering is something that tells me if my image is going to be dark or bright before I take my picture. Now I'm going to be telling you something about stops. Okay. So what I'm going to do is this is your main dial. All right. So you can see I'm going to move it three times. 1, 2, 3. Whenever I move my shutter speed in any direction three times, that means I'm changing the exposure by one stop. Okay, so maybe even this. So 1, 2, 3. So you can see my shutter speed is changing. So this is how photographers talk to each other. Suppose if I've kept a shutter speed of 1/30 and my image was bright, and if I want to communicate to my colleague that you have to make your image into correct exposure, so what you can do is just get your exposure down by one stop. It means my colleague is telling me do something that's going to make my exposure down by one full stop. One full stop means making the shutter speed fast. So 1, 2, 3. If I do it 3 times, that is a one stop change. That means if I do it just once, it's a 1/3 stop change. Okay, so like this. So again, one, you can see my F number will change now. That's my F number right now, 1.8. If I do it 3 times, one is become two. This is a 1/3 change. This is a 2/3 change. And this is a one full stop change. So when I do it 3 times, tuck, 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 it is a one full stop change. But if I do it only one tuck like this, it is a 1/3 stop change. And this is also there in the camera settings. It's called as exposure control. Okay, so you can see it's written over here in your camera settings. Exposure level increments. It is 1/3 stop or it is half stop. You can change it over here. What it basically means is whenever you move your main dial in any one direction, say like this, you can say I made the shutter speed fast by 1/3 stop. If I do it twice, 1, 2, I did it twice. That means I made the shutter speed fast by 2/3 stop. But if I do it 3 times, 1, 2, 3, you can say that I made my shutter speed fast by 1 full stop. Okay. Same with the F number. You can see my F number is 2.8. If I just do one tuck, you can say I increased my F number by 1/3 stop. If I do it twice, say 1, 2. So I'm saying that I increased my F number by 2/3 stop. If I do it 3 times, 1, 2, 3. I can communicate saying that I increased my F number by 1 full stop. So no matter what we do over here, the cursor keeps on dancing over here. So my camera is basically telling me if my image or my subject is going to be too dark or too bright, depending upon where my cursor comes. This is general photography. We use metering in general photography because the meter kind of tells us our image will be well exposed. If it's in the center, if my cursor goes on this side, it means the metering is telling me it's underexposed. And if it goes on this side, that's the plus side, it's telling me my image will be overexposed. So let us take a picture of this wall at these settings. So you can see that my camera is trying to focus on the wall. But if I take a picture at these settings, my image will be dash. Anyone? My image will be, look over here and tell me, my image will be, dark. Let me go ahead and take a shot. That is my image. It's really dark. Because the camera told me that on these settings, my image is going to be very dark, underexposed. So let me, so how do I make this image bright? There are 3 ways of getting the cursor in the center. What are they? Number one, I can make the shutter speed slower. I can make the F number less. Or I can increase my ISO. What do we do? What do we do? Can anybody tell me how do I make it a good exposure? So yes, the first thing that I'm going to do is make my shutter speed slower. It is a very fast shutter speed. 1 by 320 is a very fast shutter speed. Okay, so what I'm going to do is I'm going to make it slow. How slow can I get my shutter? Anybody? You can see my shutter has started coming. My cursor has started coming in the center. Can you see that? Can you see? My shutter is almost in the center. But till what limit can I make my shutter speed slow? Till what limit can I make my shutter speed slow? You can see even now my cursor is not in the center. Can you see that? So now I'm at 1 by 50. I'm almost in the center and I might get a good exposure, but it's slightly going to be underexposed. I took a shot and you can see the difference between the two. This is underexposed. You can see the settings also over here. This is 1 by 320 shutter speed at f5.6. And if you want to see more information, you can press the info button. So it's going to tell you each and everything. So it's going to be 1 by 320 of a second. This image was at shutter speed of 1 by 320, f5.6, ISO 400. And the histogram is showing you one line, one white line on the left hand side. That means it's fully black, almost fully black. So my question is, how slow can you make your shutter speed? So Dr. Kingshuk Chatterjee has answered it correctly. That answer is on the lens. So there is a thumb rule of keeping your shutter speed. And that thumb rule goes like this. Please understand it carefully and please try to absorb it or please write it down. Your shutter speed means SS. Your shutter speed should be faster than the inverse of your focal length of the lens. Okay, so if I give you an example, let us consider the 1855 lens again. Where is my 1855 lens? It's here. What do you mean by that? So let us try and understand it. Okay, what does this statement mean? Let us try and understand this statement, what I just said. Your shutter speed should be faster than the inverse of your focal length. Okay, so this is the focal length. So if I keep my focal length at 55, what the statement is telling me is my shutter speed should be faster than 1 by 55. Okay, so right now is 1 by 50. So whenever you are at 55, it should be faster than 1 by 55. So you can say 1 by 60 at least. I hope you got it. But if I am working at 18 mm, you can have the liberty of going slower. Means you can go up till 1 by 20. So 1 by 20 is faster than 1 by 18. That is what the statement means. But I cannot go this much. This becomes very slow. The moment you make it so slow, you will start getting blurring in your pictures because it is too slow. So if I keep my focal length at 18 mm, but my shutter speed is 1 by 15, which is lesser than 1 by 18, I am going to start getting blurring in my pictures. So if I'm going to be using 18 mm focal length, my shutter speed should be at least 1 by 20. Means at least as fast as 1 by 20. It should not be so slow. This is very slow for this lens at 18 mm. But if I go to 55 mm, this is very, very slow. So if I want to use 55 mm focal length, I have to keep a shutter speed of at least 1 by 60. This is what it means. So just remember this much. If this is your number, this should be faster. Getting it? So that is the thumb rule for shutter speed. So tell me or answer this question. If I'm going to use this lens, what should be my shutter speed? If you have understood, you will be able to answer. What should be my shutter speed at least? Should it be less than 1 by 100 or more than 1 by 100? Means faster than 1 by 100 or slower than 1 by 100? Who can answer this? If I'm using this lens, what should be my shutter speed over here? Anyone? Yeah. So Rangan Ghosh has answered. More than 1 by 100. Some people are saying faster than 1/100. MJ Vidya is saying 1/125. Megha Sharma, faster than 1/100. Shashank Kaushik, at least 1/100. Divya Prasanna, more than 1/100. Tejesh Gupta, more than 1/100. Smita Kole, more than 1/100. So most of you are right, but this is not how we speak. Shutter speed is time. You need to understand that. Shutter speed is time. So whenever you say more than or less than, you are miscommunicating with your colleague. You have to be very specific while choosing your words. Shutter speed is time, or is the speed. It cannot be more or less. Shutter speed is speed. So it can be fast or slow. So the way you speak to your colleagues is shutter speed should be faster than 1/100. In other words, you can say that it should be 1/125 at least, or something like that. There is nothing called more than 1/100 or less than 1/100 shutter speed. Be very specific so that you don't create miscommunications with your colleagues. So be very specific in choosing your words, and you should say, should I go slower than 1/100 or should I go faster than 1/100? That would be a good way to reduce the confusion between your colleagues. So let us get back to our subject over here. So my focal length is 100 mm. So my shutter speed should be faster than this. That means it should be at least 1/125. You're right. So you can choose anything faster. You can go to 1/4000 also. That is not a problem. But you cannot go slower than 1/100. That is what it means. That is what the thumb rule means. Iske niche nahi jana hai. Isse slow nahi jana hai. That is what it means in Hindi. But there might be people who don't understand Hindi. It means what I was saying, that don't go slower than 1/100. So I hope you understood the thumb rule. So that is how you decide what is going to be your shutter speed. Don't go less than 1/100 if you are choosing this lens. Be faster than 1/100. Okay. So right now I'm using a 50 mm lens. You can see over here, it's a Canon 50 mm lens. So I can take the liberty of going to 1/60 or last 1/50. But even over here, it's risky. So what I'm going to do is just keep away from risk. So what I'll do is, just to prevent blurring, I will not stay at 1/50 because I have a lot of tremors in my hand. So I'll not keep it at the death mark. I'll keep it slightly faster than 1/50. Say one stop more than 1/50. That would be 1/3, 2/3, and now one full stop. So this is 1/100 is one full stop faster than the inverse of focal length. I hope you understood what one full stop means now. So if I do slow, if I slow it down by one full stop, it'll become C. See, 1, 2, and 3. So I've come to 1/50. If I say go one full stop faster than 1/50, you have to do it thrice. 1, 2, and 3. So this is one full stop faster than 1/50. That is how we speak to each other. That is how we photographers talk to each other. So let me keep a shutter speed of 1/50. That is going to prevent blurring that's going to be taking place. And let me see where my cursor is going. So now my problem is my cursor is stuck at -2. If I take an image over here, it's going to be dark. It's not focusing because minimum focusing distance, I have crossed that limit. Yeah, you can see that I'm at -2. So my image will be dash. My image will be dash. My image will be underexposed. So you can see that my image is underexposed. Let me show you the image. It is there, but it is underexposed. You can see it quite clearly here. How do I still get my cursor in the center? Now I have left with two options, F and ISO. You need to understand that my ISO is already 400. That means it's pretty high. So I'm going to get a lot of noise. So there are two ways of getting my cursor in the center after my shutter speed has been already set. That is, either I increase my ISO or I reduce my F number. What do you want me to do? Can anybody tell me? If I increase my ISO, what is going to happen? It will become bright, but dash. What will happen? I am going to get a lot of noise. Perfect. This is something that I don't want to touch right now. So what I'm going to do is play with my F number to get the cursor in the center. Right now there is no cursor because I have not done a half release. If I do a half release, only then my cursor is going to come back and meter my camera. So now my only option is not to play with my ISO, because if I increase my ISO to bring the cursor in the center, it's going to lead to a high amount of noise. So my only option is reduce the F number. Okay, so let me reduce the F number and see where my cursor is going. So right now my cursor is at -2. So let me reduce the F number. Yes, you can see it's coming in the center. Very good. Perfect. So can you tell me how many stops I passed? I was at F5.6, I think. Let me see what F number I was at before. I was at 5.6. Yeah, see, I was at 5.6. Let me count how many stops am I changing to get my cursor in the center. Okay, I'm using a 50mm lens, 50mm 1.8 lens is written on my lens, 50mm 1.8. So I can go as low as 1.8. So let me count and see how many stops is it taking for my cursor to come in the center. Okay, so 1, 2, 3, that is one full stop. 1, 2, 3, that is two full stops and one more. So I think my cursor is right in the center. So it took me two full stops and one more one third stop. So you can say 2 plus 1/3 stop. If I take a picture now, it's going to be well exposed. Okay, let me take a picture and see. Yeah, it is well exposed now. Can you all appreciate? So let us see all the settings. Oh, but how did this change? I think I pressed my shutter by mistake. So let me get my shutter back to 1/100. This is where I was, sorry. And this is where I was. I was at this situation. Shutter was 1/100, F was at 5.6. Now let me try and bring my cursor in the center. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 6 times means 2 stops. But still my cursor is not in the center. So I'm going to do one more tuck. So it is 2/1/3 stop and I'm going to be taking a picture now. So let's take a picture 1, 2, and 3. So the cursor was right in the center and you can appreciate that the image is very well exposed. I hope you all can appreciate. So I had to do 2 full stops and one more 1/3 stop to get the cursor in the center. Okay, but even at ISO 400, I am going to have a lot of noise. So my most important thing in general photography is to keep my ISO as low as possible. Okay, so this is how you decide your settings if you are doing general photography. First thing is set your shutter speed according to the thumb rule. So if you are using a 50mm lens, the slowest that you can go is 1/50. If you go slower than this, you are going to encounter blurring. So let me be faster than 1/50. So you can say 1/60. Okay. So at this shutter speed and ISO 100. ISO 100 means I'm going to have minimum amount of noise. But you can see that ISO 100 at 1/60, I'm getting an underexposure. That is, my cursor is on the -1 side. So what I'm going to do is reduce the F number. Okay. 2. Okay. So sorry. I'm reducing the shutter. Reduce my F number. So 1, 2, 3. That is, I'm almost in the center now. See that? Perfect. So this is how I decide my F number. So let me take a picture and it's going to be correctly exposed. So this is how I decide my settings. Shutter speed, I keep faster than the inverse of my focal length. So if I'm using 50 mm, I keep it at least 1 by 60 seconds. Sorry. I keep my ISO at 100 so that there is minimum noise. And the last thing that I do is play with my F number. Okay, sometimes what is going to happen is, even at a minimum F number, so in this situation on this lens, my minimum F number is 18. Sorry, it is 1 by 8. Okay, but you sometimes still get an underexposure. So instead of pointing at a white wall, let me point at this wall, which is slightly darker as compared to my white wall. So now in this same situation, I think I might get an underexposure. So what I'm going to do to confirm is do a half release and see if my cursor is going to go on the minus side. And it did. You can see that if I take a picture now, it is going to be underexposed. Can you see that? It is quite underexposed. So at 1 by 60, which is the slowest that I can go with this lens in order to reduce blurring, at ISO 100 and f1.8, I am getting an underexposure for this subject, which is quite dark. Now, I have no option. I cannot reduce my F even more because this is the minimum F number that is written on my lens. See over here, 50 mm, 1 is to 1.8. 1 is to 1.8 is your minimum F number of the lens. This is not magnification ratio. This is the minimum F number of your lens. 1 is to 1.8 written in front of the lens is your minimum F number. So this lens cannot go lesser than 1.8. Let me show that to you. See, you can go more, but you cannot go less. So this is the minimum. You can go more, but you cannot go less than 1.8, no matter what you do. Okay, so I'm already at the slowest shutter speed for this subject and at the minimum possible F number, but my cursor is still on the minus side. Can you see? My cursor is still on the minus side. So now my only option is to increase the ISO. So what I'm doing is increase the ISO like that. And I'll see if I can get the cursor in the center. Yeah, it's almost in the center. Yeah. And I'll take a shot and see. Yeah, this is a well exposed image. Because it was almost in the center. So you can see the difference. I'll show you all the settings. So shutter speed, we've already understood. Since I'm using 50 mm lens, it should be at least 1 by 60. That means faster than the inverse of focal length. F1.8 because the lighting is very poor, or you can see my subject is very dark. And ISO 100, I got an underexposure. So this is the slowest that I could have gone. And 1.8 is the minimum F number that I could have achieved. So now my only option was left is to increase my ISO. So I increased my ISO to 400. And I got a well exposed image of my subject because the cursor came in the center. So you can see it is quite well exposed now. But you can see my depth of field is very shallow. My entire door is not sharp. Only the center part is sharp. This is blurred and this is blurred. This is actually what we want in general photography. In general photography, we actually want shallow depth of field. That's the main difference between dental photography and general photography. In general photography, we work with shallow depth of field so that we bring out the beauty of our subject. All right. So I hope you all understood what metering is. Metering basically means that cursor that comes on your camera like this. If your cursor goes on the right hand side, the camera is telling you before you take the shot itself that your image will be overexposed. If it goes in the center, it's correctly exposed. If it goes on the minus side, it is underexposed. Where it is coming is controlled by these three settings, that is the shutter, F number and ISO. Your shutter should be faster than the inverse of your focal length. So if you're using 50 mm lens, it should be at least 1 by 60. The next thing that you set is your F number. Try to keep your F number minimum for general photography because you want a shallow depth of field. So the minimum F number for me on this lens is 1x8. That is why I've chosen 1x8. And the last thing that you want to play with is ISO. Try to keep your ISO as minimum as possible. So these are the guidelines to set your general photography settings. Basically, your F number will be based on your visualization or your imagination. If your imagination wants that the depth of field should be shallow, choose smaller F numbers. Are you getting it? Okay, so if I want a deeper depth of field, I'll increase my F number. So that is your liberty. It is your imagination. If you want a shallow depth of field or if you want a deeper depth of field. I'll give you a very practical example. Sometimes if I take a picture of a dog, its eyes are very beautiful. So I want a shallow depth of field. I want only the eyes to be sharp and the entire face of the dog to be blurred. So what I do is I shoot at the minimum F number. That means my depth of field is going to be very shallow. And then I decide my ISO depending upon where I'm getting the cursor. Okay, but sometimes if I want the eyes as well as the nose of the dog to be sharp, I increase my F number. So in that case, again, my ISO changes according to my F number. But my shutter speed always remains faster, a little faster than the inverse of my focal length. Okay, so I hope you enjoyed today's session. And if you have any questions, I'll be more than happy to answer them. Do we have any questions? So if your shutter speed and F number are not helping you, you have to change your ISO. You'll have to play with your ISO. But playing with the ISO should be the last thing for us. Kari Kalan is saying, if we use inbuilt flash or studio light, how to do metering? So in flash photography, we don't do metering. And that is what you understood. Like in dental photography, for so many sessions, I never spoke about metering. That's because we don't consider metering in flash photography. Because we use flash on manual mode. Rangan Ghosh, what is the depth of field for landscape photography? See, in landscape photography, you want everything sharp. So you are going to get that anyways because you use a wide angle lens. Don't worry about that. Liji, awesome session. Thank you so much. Hemant, great session. Thank you, Hemant. Do we have any more questions? Any more questions? See, in landscape photography, you use a wide angle lens like 18 mm. So at 18 mm focal length, everything is going to be sharp. So F number is not that important in landscape photography. F number is more important in products, portraits, wildlife, all these things. Landscape photography, everything will be sharp. So when you use a wide angle lens, in fact, whenever you use a phone and take a picture of the beach or mountains, everything is sharp because it's a wide angle lens. So whenever you use a wide angle lens, it's inherently going to have a very deeper depth of field. So don't worry about landscape photography and depth of fields. Smita is asking, sir, there is always a graphic presentation of the image. How should one read it? It's called as an image histogram. This is how we read. In fact, I'm going to be conducting a session on histogram. Look at the histogram right now. Okay, so you press the info button to have a look at the histogram. So you can see that my distribution of the histogram is almost on the left hand side in this image. That means quite a lot is underexposed, but I have a lot of it in the center also. So the center part is well exposed and a lot of part is in the left. So you try to get this graph in the center. Again, how to get the graph in the center is by using these three settings only. Okay, so any more questions? I'm going to be conducting a session on histogram for all of you all. Don't worry about it. I'm looking for questions. Divya Prasanna is asking, does the thumb rule apply for all type of photography? Yes, it is a thumb rule for a reason. But if you have a tripod, you don't have to worry about the thumb rule. So if you use a tripod, you can go slower than the inverse of focal length also. Or provided you know how to manage that situation with different techniques. But for a beginner, let the thumb rule be. We'll discuss about different ways of overcoming it in future. But using a tripod is one of the ways, Divya. Mohammad Alshiri, thank you so much. Tejesh, awesome session, thank you. Shashank explained beautifully in detail, thank you. Mayur, thank you. Sudarshan is asking, there is an adjustment where we can do the same setting in metering bar. What does that mean and when should we touch the setting? Sudarshan, that answer is coming in our next session in general photography, when I'm going to be teaching you how to use AV mode. Liji is asking, sir, this is out of topic question, but how you make your presentation PPTs, they are really impressive. Any sessions coming up on the same? Yes, Liji, I'm going to be keeping one session for postgraduate students wherein I'm going to be teaching them how to make good presentations, in the sense how to make PowerPoint and how to make a keynote session, how to add animations, what are the kind of fonts that you are supposed to be using, what fonts you are not supposed to be using, how to present it nicely. There is going to be a very elaborate, in fact, there will be a completely different series on presentations. Okay, Nandan, how to lock shutter speed when doing metering? Nandan, that's a very good question and I'm going to be answering it in our forthcoming sessions. I don't want to confuse you or bombard you all with a lot of information, but this question is going to be answered in our next session, that is how to use AV mode and TV mode. Okay, Rangan Ghosh, will there be an editing software session? Yes, we are going to be doing editing. Divya, okay, great sir, thank you so much. Thank you so much, Divya. Aishwarya, sir, what does the AFL near viewfinder mean? It's called auto exposure lock and auto focus lock. I'm going to cover this in our next session. It is mainly used to help you with compositions and I'm going to be teaching you that. That's a very important thing. Smita, waiting for the next presentation. I'm so honored to have you in my session, Smita. I'm just checking if we have more questions. King Shuk, kindly do a session on off-camera flash photography. Yes, King Shuk, in fact, we've already done an off-camera flash. You can check out our session dated April 7th, which was on flash. I have covered slave mode flash photography in that, but I'll cover it once again for you, King Shuk. I'm really happy that you came for the session, King Shuk. Hemant, waiting for the next editing session. Thank you. Just checking for questions. Shekhar joined us. Shekhar, hi Shekhar, how are you? Gaurav, thank you. Okay, I think next session topic will be a continuation of this itself. It'll be a continuation of general photography itself. I'll let you know when the next session is. By most probability, it will be very soon. Okay, but keep updated with my Facebook and Instagram stories. You will come to know about the next session. I think that is all about the question. Yes, King Shuk, I'll be doing a session on off-camera flash, don't worry. So thank you so much everybody for joining me. I'm glad you enjoyed the session. Please keep in mind the forthcoming session will be on the Dental Photography School Facebook group and not the Dental Photography School Facebook page. It was an honor and a pleasure to have your company. Thank you so much, Kari Kalan. Thank you everyone. Thank you, Rangan Ghosh. Thank you, Tejesh Gupta. Thank you, Smita Kole, Ashwini, Karpe, Aishwarya Ahar. Thank you, Divya. Thank you, Rangan Ghosh. Thank you, Nandan Sate. Thank you, Liji John. Thank you, Sudarshan Kakad. Thank you, King Shuk. Thank you, Hemant. Thank you, Madan. Thank you, Shashank. Thank you, Dr. S.P. Singh. Thank you, Dr. Rukmani Rana and others. I'll be looking forward to see you in our next session. If you like this session, please do share it with your friends and host a watch party so that a lot more people get benefited from this session. Thank you so much, Dr. Madhivanan and Pratima Kedar Vartak from Saudi, I think Dubai. It was an honor and a pleasure to have your company. Most probably the next session might be tomorrow or the day after. Please keep in touch with my Facebook or Instagram stories or WhatsApp status. I'll be posting about the next session on my WhatsApp status or Insta stories or Facebook stories. Thank you, Giftlin, Denny, Xavier. Thank you, Sudarshan. It was a pleasure. Calling it off now. Thank you so much. Thank you.